In the first video in this series of the Sun and climate, we saw how we know that the Sun has been responsible for some of the major climate changes that have occurred over the past 11,000 years. In the second video, we looked at a whole range of changes that the Sun is causing in the climate today for which we have no explanation, including changes in the planet's rotation and in the polar vortex that are changing the frequency of cold winters. The IPCC does not accept the evidence we have reviewed. It is a political organization advised by scientists chosen at the suggestion of governments who decide what to include and what not to include in the reports. None of the evidence for the Sun's effect on climate is included. The role of the IPCC is to assess the risk of human-induced climate change, not to find the causes of climate change, which, since its inception, has been assumed to be due to our emissions. But a few scientists, often attacked and obstructed, continue to try to explain the Sun's effect on climate and have developed three different explanations. These three theories are not mutually exclusive. The fact that one is true does not mean that the others are false. The first theory is based on the direct effect on climate of changes in solar radiation. Because the effect is proportional to the cause, we say it is linear. This theory has been defended by Dr. Sun, Professor Scafetta, and 35 other scientists in a recent paper. To explain the Sun's effect on climate, these scientists make their own temperature reconstruction based on rural stations to avoid the urban heat effect and their own reconstruction of solar activity over the last 2 centuries. The graph on the left shows the reconstruction compared to the one accepted by the IPCC on the right. The difference between the two would explain a much larger effect of the Sun on climate than that accepted by the IPCC. In the second theory, it is cosmic rays that change the climate, and the Sun's magnetic field regulates the amount of cosmic rays that reach the Earth. It is therefore an indirect effect, but also a linear one, since the change in cosmic rays would be proportional to the activity of the Sun. This theory, proposed by Dr. Svensmark, is based on the fact that cosmic rays create ions in the atmosphere that act as cloud seeds. Part of the theory has been confirmed by experiments in a particle accelerator, but it is not yet known whether the effect is significant enough. One problem is that cosmic rays have increased while satellites show a decrease in the low cloud layer, which may actually contribute to the observed warming. The third theory is the one I have proposed. In it, the Sun is not indispensable to natural climate change. There is a poorly understood climate process that is affected by the Sun, but also by several other factors. Change in this process causes changes in the climate. The Sun acts indirectly on the climate, and its effect is non-linear because other factors are involved. Non-linear means that the effect is not proportional to the cause. This explains why there is no direct correlation between the Sun and surface temperatures, nor should there be, although the Sun's effect is important. What is this process capable of changing the climate in a natural way that scientists have not properly accounted for? It is heat transport. What is heat transport? Most of the Sun's energy reaches the Earth in the tropics, creating a zone of excess energy that receives more energy than it emits, shown in red in the figure. Outside the tropics, there are two energy deficit zones, which receive less energy than they emit and whose size depends on the seasons. They are shown in blue in the figure, which presents the situation during winter in the northern hemisphere. These imbalances should result in continuous warming in the red zone and continuous cooling in the blue zones. That this does not happen is due to the transport of heat, which also transports moisture and clouds, and is very important for the climate. The climate of any region depends on insolation and the transport of heat and moisture. But heat transport is a gap in our knowledge of the climate. There are several reasons for this. The first is that it responds to very complicated physics, and as the scientists who study themselves of knowledge, we do not have satisfactory theories to describe it. In addition, we cannot adequately measure it because it is constantly occurring in the atmosphere and in the oceans, and it varies greatly throughout the year. From satellites, a global calculation of heat transport is made, but we cannot distinguish the variations in what is transported by the atmosphere and what is transported by the ocean. The seasonal variation is very important because of the tilt of the planet's axis. Much more heat is transported in the winter than in the summer, And some of the heat goes in and out of the ocean without being adequately measured. Because we know almost nothing about heat transport, the models do not know it either. And although they can be made to reproduce the total annual amount transported, they are not able to do so in the same way as the climate. Despite this lack of knowledge, most scientists believe that variations in heat transport have not contributed to recent climate change. Why do they believe that, given their lack of knowledge? The first reason is that when heat is transported horizontally within the climate system, the amount of heat contained in the system is not changed, and that heat continues to produce the same infrared emissions to space. Therefore, heat transport cannot cause global climate change, only regional changes. Is this true? Actually, it is not. It is rarely mentioned, but 75% of the Earth's greenhouse effect is due to water vapor and water clouds, and their distribution by latitude is extremely uneven. The tropical atmosphere contains a lot of water, and the polar atmosphere in winter contains almost none. Therefore, the greenhouse effect in the polar regions is extremely small, and the transport of heat from the tropics to the Arctic changes the emissions. This means that the total is not constant, so heat transport has the ability to change the global climate. If the total amount of heat transported were always the same, the transport would not cause climate change. And this is what many scientists believe. They believe that as heat transport through the atmosphere increases, heat transport through the ocean decreases, compensating for the change, and the total amount does not change. This theoretical compensation, which has never been proven, appears differently in each model without knowing its physical basis. This means that for these scientists and models, transport is not a cause of climate change. But again, reality is different. Heat transport can increase in the atmosphere and also in the ocean, changing the amount of energy transported. In fact, this is logical because most ocean transport is in surface currents driven by wind, which is also responsible for heat transport through the atmosphere. If the wind increases, the transport in both compartments must increase. This is also supported by data from two studies of Arctic heat transport in recent decades. Both atmospheric and oceanic heat transport increased in the early 21st century. According to theory and models, this is not possible, and yet the effects of this increased heat transport could not be clearer. In the Arctic, winter temperatures have risen sharply. Obviously, that heat has to be transported there because the sun does not shine in the Arctic in winter, so no heat is generated. And the increase in temperature has greatly increased the emission of infrared radiation into space. Remember that the greenhouse effect is very weak in the Arctic at this time of the year, and heat is not retained. Because of the warming of the Arctic caused by increased transport, the planet is losing more energy than it was losing before. So what has caused this warming of the Arctic in the 21st century? Scientists say it was the increase in CO2, but that is not possible. CO2 has been rising sharply since the 1950s, and its effects on radiation are instantaneous. They do not take 50 years. There's also talk of it being a consequence of the warming that's been going on since the mid-1970s, but that's not possible either. Why should it take 2 decades for the heat to reach the Arctic? We have the sun. Arctic warming and increased outgoing radiation coincide in time with the declining solar activity that began in the mid-1990s with solar cycle 23, which, as we have seen, was accompanied by the weakening of the polar vortex. How do we know that the change in solar activity caused the change in transport and the warming of the Arctic? Because it has been doing so for thousands of years. This study by leading scientists looked at the relationship between solar activity and Greenland's temperature and found that over the past 4,000 years, solar activity has been inversely correlated with Greenland's temperature. When solar activity decreased, Greenland warmed, as it is doing now. It also says that there have been periods in those 4,000 years when Greenland was warmer than it is now, which is inconsistent with being caused by our emissions. How can solar activity cause changes in heat transport? The signal from the sun is received in the stratospheric ozone layer, which absorbs much of the ultraviolet radiation. This is a very sensitive receiver, because UV radiation changes 30 times more than total radiation. 3%. But in addition, the increase in UV radiation creates more ozone, which also increases by 3%. With more ozone and more UV radiation, the ozone layer experiences a temperature increase of 1 degree Celsius with solar activity, which is much more than at the surface. The ozone response to changes in solar activity modifies the temperature and pressure gradients, and this causes the speed of the zonal winds in the stratosphere to change, as we saw earlier. In the figure, these winds are shown as circles, and the stronger the winds, the more circles there are, and the darker their color. When the activity is high, the gradients become larger, and this causes the wind speed to increase, and when the activity is low, the gradients become smaller, and the wind speed decreases. In the troposphere, atmospheric waves, called planetary waves, are generated, and when the wind is weak, they reach the stratosphere and hit the polar vortex, weakening it. But when the wind is strong, they do not manage to enter the stratosphere, and the vortex remains strong. Changes in the vortex are transmitted to the troposphere, altering atmospheric circulation and heat transport. Planetary waves are atmospheric waves of the Rossby type. They are like ocean waves in three dimensions and of gigantic size. The largest storms on the planet fit into their undulations and have a huge impact on meteorology. They are responsible for some of the most extreme atmospheric phenomena, such as the heat waves in Europe in 2003 and in Russia in 2010, and the floods in Pakistan in 2010, in China in 2012, and in Europe in 2013. The amount of energy they move is staggering. Planetary waves are the largest of all, and under certain conditions can reach the stratosphere, hitting the polar vortex and weakening it. 50 years ago, a scientist suggested that if the sun had an effect on climate, planetary waves were a possible candidate for the mechanism, but no one investigated this possibility and the paper was forgotten. A 2011 study finally proved him right, showing that planetary waves in the northern hemisphere respond to the solar cycle. The graph shows the sunspot cycle in red and the amplitude of the planetary waves in black. We observe large oscillations from one year to another because the mechanism is not exclusive to the sun, and there are other causes that affect it. This is the difficulty of studying nonlinear phenomena. But the effect of the solar cycle is clear because the highest amplitudes occur in periods of low solar activity. The effect this has on the polar vortex was seen earlier in this graph. More active solar cycles with fewer planetary waves have faster zonal winds and stronger vortices, while during less active solar cycles, the increase in planetary waves weakens the vortex. We have already mentioned the effect this has on the frequency of cold winters in the northern hemisphere. But how does this mechanism explain the change in global climate? My theory is that when solar activity is high, the zonal winds are strengthened, preventing the planetary waves from entering the stratosphere and allowing the vortex to remain strong throughout the winter. By acting as a wall, the vortex reduces heat transport to the Arctic in winter, and this causes temperatures to drop, reducing the infrared emissions to space that allow heat to escape from the Earth. All of these steps have been verified by scientists. The result is that by reducing emissions, the planet conserves more energy, which can cause it to get warmer. This is the situation that occurred from the mid-1970s to the late 1990s, when the planet experienced a strong warming under high solar activity. When solar activity is low, the zonal winds subside, allowing planetary waves to enter the stratosphere and hit the vortex, weakening it. As the wall weakens, heat transport to the Arctic increases, causing it to warm. This warming increases emissions to space, causing the planet to conserve less energy. The result is that the planet either warms more slowly or cools, depending on other factors. Because this mechanism regulates the amount of heat that enters the Arctic in winter, I have named my theory the Winter Gatekeeper. It is important to note that this is not a solar theory, although it does explain the sun's effect on climate. Variations in heat transport are a general cause of climate change, perhaps the most important. Any factor that persistently changes the amount of heat transported becomes a cause of climate change, and this includes plate tectonics and orbital variations. This theory has the ability to explain the ice age of the last 34 million years and the growth and shrinkage of the ice age in glaciations and interglacials. The explanations it provides fit the evidence better than the CO2 changes. The solar mechanism I propose has the following features. It is indirect, because what changes the climate is not the change in solar energy, but the change in heat transport. It is exclusively due to changes in the sun's ultraviolet radiation. It produces dynamic changes in the stratosphere, which is the part of the climate system whose response to the sun is important for climate change. The mechanism works by altering the propagation of planetary waves, as proposed 50 years ago. Since there are multiple causes that affect this propagation, the cause-effect relationship becomes nonlinear, which makes it very difficult to study because we humans think linearly. It affects the polar vortex, which is responsible for transmitting what happens in the stratosphere to the troposphere, determining the position of the jet streams and the atmospheric circulation in winter. In its final part, the mechanism alters the transport of heat to the Arctic in winter. This is the most visible effect of the sun on climate. Winter temperatures in the Arctic and the frequency of cold winters in eastern North America and Eurasia reveal the sun's effect on climate. Finally, the mechanism works because the greenhouse effect is extremely heterogeneous across the planet. It is a very thick blanket in the tropics, leaving the poles exposed. Increasing CO2 doesn't change that, because most of the greenhouse effect is due to water, which changes much more than CO2. This theory explains many of the problems that the sun's effect on climate has always had. It explains the mismatch between the small change in solar energy and the resulting climate effect. The change in solar energy only provides the signal, like the finger pushing the button on an elevator. The energy to change the climate is provided by planetary waves, which carry very large amounts of energy and act on sensitive parts of the climate. It explains the lack of cause and effect correlation claimed by NASA and the IPCC. It is a nonlinear process that cannot be required to have a linear correlation. It explains the recent warming of the Arctic, the timing of which cannot be explained by CO2 or global warming. It explains the recent increase in cold winters in the Northern Hemisphere that scientists cannot adequately explain. It explains changes in the Earth's rotation due to the sun that no one has been able to explain. Changes in atmospheric circulation induced by the sun are what alter the angular momentum responsible for variations in the Earth's rotation. It explains the cumulative effect of changes in solar activity on climate, why grand solar minimums have such a large effect proportional to their duration. Low activity alters the energy balance by increasing emissions throughout the duration of the grand minimum, progressively reducing the energy of the climate system and causing the effects to become larger and more global over time. It explains the greater impact of solar-induced climate change on the Northern Hemisphere, as it affects the heat transport to the Arctic. The Antarctic polar vortex is much stronger and less sensitive to solar forcing. This is why the medieval warm period and the Little Ice Age caused by solar forcing were much more pronounced in the Northern Hemisphere. It also explains a significant part of the 20th century warming. The 70 years of grand solar maximum in that century caused the planet to increase its energy and warm up. The sun has a lot to say about future climate, but we are not listening. Long-term changes in solar activity are cyclical, and what adds to warming now will subtract from it in the future. This theory does not deny that changes in CO2 affect climate, and indeed it is based on differences in emission due to changes in the greenhouse effect. Just not in time, but in space, with latitude. But it is undeniable that if the sun has played a relevant role in the warming of the 20th century, it reduces the role our emissions have played. The climate emergency is not so, and waiting until we are sure is the most prudent thing to do, because predictions that ignore such an important factor will fail, and the enormous cost incurred will not be recovered. In the meantime, if you like climate science and want to know more, you can buy my books, which are available on Amazon and other online stores. You can also subscribe to my YouTube channel.